As the matter advanced to an appeal of a ZBA decision, I proactively contacted town council and state ethics board attorneys for a fuller discussion and written clarification on all guidelines regarding exactly what I could and could not do more generally, that is outside the board, as a citizen and as a town official. I received, discussed, understood, and have strictly followed these guidelines. For example, on the town official side, I have, number one, not participated in any planning board activities on the 255 matter. Number two, not discussed or tried to influence any planning board member, any other town official, or any town employee on the 255 matter. Number three, physically exited the room during all planning board and town discussions of the 255 matter. I specifically asked if I should resign from the planning board, and the answer was that this was not necessary. On the citizen side, rather than just being general, I listed and received documented approval for all of my neighborhood activities. I'd like to also report that in 2015, when I was recruited by the planning board to run for membership, the recruiting member knew of my required recusal and shared no concerns. In 2019, when I was elected to the chair by my members, with the 255 matter still pending and my recusal in full effect and widely known, members shared no concerns. I'll now move to last week's actions. Very frankly, while sensitive to the underlying stress to others caused by my recusal, I found the actions disappointing. I'll explain why in 3 points of feedback. Number one, I found the choice to surprise Leslie and me with a motion to replace me midterm versus to have a collaborative discussion about the underlying concerns and find a solution to be an unnecessary and unfortunate ambush. This choice allowed for no team problem solving, was divisive and rushed, and treated me, a four-year member partner, and your chair, and the chair position with undue respect. Put another way, it did not make a great advertisement for citizens to volunteer for town government. Point number two of feedback. I found the reasons for removal to be unsound. Of note, you claimed that you need full-time leadership, but proposed a three-person shared chair as a solution. As town council has now advised, a three-person shared chair is impractical as it would require you to hold public meetings, even to create or update agendas. If you were thinking of a three-person rotating chair for the 4 months that remain in my term, that's really temporary versus full-time leadership and impractical as well, resulting in ongoing transition challenges for yourselves, the town planner, and applicants. These options are far worse than today's situation. Of note, you suggested reasons of, quote, backdoor meetings on the 255 matter between Chris Houston and me, but there were none. Also, unfortunately, claiming the grapevine is your source, you never asked me if it was true before taking these actions. Of note, you suggested reasons that my recusal has been difficult for you, but you never explained how the actions would make things any less difficult for you. I'll also assert that recusals are a fundamental and required concept in operating government, especially small volunteer government. They allow officials to maintain their positions and properly exit from matters that hold self-interest. They are a regular occurrence and with established procedures and guidelines. They are also a two-way street. Both sides have a role in and responsibility to honor recusals and compartmentalize recusal matters from other matters. Furthermore, in explicitly rejecting Leslie's proposal for me to reassume the chair when the 255 matter was settled and my recusal was lifted, you called into question the concern as a motivation for your action. Perhaps the most concerning reasoning to me was your statement that you don't, quote, need a justification for removing me. Of course, the statement is legally true. You can indeed remove a chair for no reason at all outside of discrimination. But I would suggest it's very poor form for a town decision-making body to even contemplate making an arbitrary decision on a very serious matter. I would argue the planning board needs to aim higher. we owe voters and ourselves valid justifications for our decisions. My final point of feedback, I found serious miscommunication regarding the legal approval of your proposed actions. When I expressed legal concerns during the meeting, you assured me, quote, "I spoke to Leon, the town manager, on Monday. Leon consulted with town council and raised no issues. Neither raised issues with it, the motion to change the chair, being brought up and voted on today, that day. In an email to me the following day, Leon reported on his conversation with you. I can definitely say that I did not say this, raising the issue under citizen comments, was approved by council. The subject of a three-person chair of the committee was never discussed with me nor council. I don't recall speaking regarding the length of the appointment of chairman. These are serious discrepancies, and clearly the legal coast was not clear as you conveyed. Regardless of whose recall was exactly right or wrong, you planned and took the action. You had plenty of time to consider, confirm, and remove all uncertainty on the legality of the action and seek town council's opinion, especially if you were reporting that it was. In retrospect and in the full light of day, proposed action was indeed not proper and likely not legal, and we're lucky that we did not proceed." Okay, I'm done with that difficult review. I feel the actions that night were isolated and unlike you, and I'm ready to talk solutions. From what I can tell, you need and want continuous leadership on the 255 matter. As things are now, you must appoint a chair to each meeting, and it's confusing how to manage matters between meetings. I can understand that this is inefficient and stressful. After discussion with town council, I propose that the best solution is to appoint a vice chair to lead all 255 related matters in my absence. This removes the uncertainty of who leads each meeting and allows the leader to plan and work effectively and confidently between meetings. I'd also suggest appointing a planning board associate to assist with the 255 matters, but have been told by town council that there's no such legal provision. Finally, about me. You appointed me to a one-year term. I took this appointment seriously and wish to complete that term. I'm happy with our progress under my leadership, and I've started or co-started initiatives that I feel demand the position of chair for the remainder of my year to confidently take the next steps. These three initiatives are, number one, a holistic plan to preserve our tree canopy. By holistic, I mean trees on public and private land, and I mean engaging all needed town organizations to create and implement a practical plan, including the select board, DPW, and the tree advisory group, and the planning board. I feel this effort is off to an inspired start, thanks to many, and all are eager to take the next steps. B, a transportation plan to mitigate commuter time traffic. A six-month study spanning over 40 transportation experts was chosen by our six-month study spanning over 40 transportation experts was chosen by MassDOT for present at its annual Transportation Innovation Conference. The resulting plan became real just this week with our launch of the Where to Weston Commuter Survey, which will drive decisions on 2 to 3 town pilots to encourage shared commuting, reduce congestion, and improve commutes. I understand we have had over 100 respondents in our first day. As we're not in this traffic situation alone, we're preparing to pitch surrounding towns to take similar actions or collaborate directly with us. And finally, C, continued streamlining of planning board permitting. For the sake of members, residents, and developers, we've already cut back on meeting time without sacrificing quality. And we are commencing a working group with developers and residents looking for practical, quote, improvement opportunities and scenic road reviews. Overall, I feel me serving out my one-year chair term and the board appointing a vice chair to lead 255 matters is best for the board to continue to function well, improve, and deal with the 255 recusal matter. So now I will make a motion to create a position of vice chair for the planning board, serving as chair on matters on which the chair has recused himself. Do I hear a second?
A second. Point of order, we still have the tabled motion from last meeting, which is tabled until lifted, moved from the table.
Yes.
So moved to take the motion from the table. So to...
I'm going to turn to town council for an answer on that.
I think it's fine to talk about the motion that you just made and maybe come back to that after.
Okay. We potentially can come back to it. We'll deal with the motion on the table right now.
I think we...
In sequence, what I'd like to do, I'd like, given that Leslie was left out of the last round of discussions, I'd like Leslie to go first in the debate, if she has things to say. And then I'd like to go from a seniority standpoint, so I'd like to hear from Stu, I'd like to hear from Steve, and I'd like to hear from Alicia. And then we'll turn to the audience. Leslie?
So you want responses to what you just read, or the
motion? The motion is being debated.
Okay, all right. I must admit, I'm going to ask, I seconded because I think it sounded like that was a vice chair or that was the associate.
That was a vice chair.
That was a vice chair.
Yeah, vice chair.
I actually think that's an excellent idea, and I think if we had a vice chair from square one, we would not be in the predicament we are today.
Right.
Because as we discussed last time, life happens, and the chair cannot always fill the positions or attend all the meetings that there might be required to. A vice chair basically knows their responsibilities. The rest of the committee knows who to turn to, and it makes logical sense. As far as I understand it, that's how all the committees in Weston have always been set up. Why we haven't done it? Well, we haven't done a lot of things in the intervening years. And I think that doing a vice chair who can take over when Tony can't do it makes a world of sense.
Sue?
All right, well, I'm going to start with just something that I sent today to Leon, because of the two issues for tonight's meeting. This is, first, the question is the chairman of the planning board. Tony has unfortunately lost the confidence of the three remaining members in his ability to lead us through our work as a board. We all of us took an oath of office when we were elected to the board to perform the duties related to our office. Our duties are to represent the entire town in the area of land use. He should have represented the entire town, not just his own neighborhood, and by his recusal, was unable to perform in the full capacity of the office. During the presentation by Chris Houston at the select board meeting last week, he speaks of the many productive meetings with our former chairman, Al Adeloff, and therein lies the problem. During Tony's recusal, speaking to the SB or communicating the planning board's position, I am not impugning Tony or suggesting that he has any other motive other than to comply with state ethics, but the results were the same for our board. We were deprived of vital leadership. That said, I am interested in hearing more about the vice chair. And I wonder what people would say on that. It was truly the extremely stressful time at the town meeting when we were literally bushwhacked. We had come up to that sort of expecting that somebody was in charge of this, and I just didn't realize that you had completely removed yourself, and then you got up and said you guys were on your own at town meeting, and we were gobsmacked, and it was an extremely difficult time, mostly because town council had advised us, Katie, that, you know, it had sent that letter back in July. We'd all read it. We all thought we understood it. I know some people felt we just didn't understand it, the issue, and needed to explain it to us multiple times. But we stood up and we defended it as best we could. And this was against a line of people who were proponents. And we were alone. It was very stressful. It made us lack confidence in where we were at this point in time. We had no leadership on 255, or at that point it was Tossie. So this was the response, and but I'm not averse.
I'm just puzzled to, like, recusals are a fundamental component of government.
They are, but we...
So I'm not allowed to be your leader on that issue.
I realize that. This was our naivete, that we, as I said, you know, Chris pointed out that he would meet regularly with Al. It did not dawn on any of us that no one was meeting with the board, the select board, and keeping them informed of what was going on.
You did elect Steve to be the chair in my absence.
At that meeting. It was late to the game. We were very abandoned, I think is probably the word, and that's how we felt.
Okay. guess I can take some blame if it was not so clear that I had recused myself and you needed more of a permanent leader.
And we can take blame that we were naive and did not realize that this was the case.
Right. And is the vice chair something that you would feel favorable up to?
My goal is to have somebody who stays on top of this.
The 255 map.
The 255 map. Someone who's involved deeply in it, who knows zoning bylaws far better than some of us do on this committee, be that our town council or whoever, but it needs oversight. I'm very uncomfortable unless we have someone really paying attention to this.
Okay, I can't wait and to have to tell you to do a great job with the 255 matter.
Yeah.
But very, very generally, like any matter, could use a good leader. So that's why I think a vice chair is a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Now the question comes, does that one of us on
one
this
of you
board,
three would be the vice
one
chair.
Of us, one of we three.
Right, exactly. Leslie can't be. I can't.
Correct.
I can, as I did, I made the motion to establish the position of a vice chair.
Mm-hmm.
I can't be a part of electing the vice chair, according to council.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Okay. So you would separately, at our next meeting, it's not on the agenda tonight,
mm-hmm.
so we can't vote on it.
Mm-hmm.
But at our next meeting, you three would debate and vote on a vice chair on the 255 matter. And then that person would serve on a continuous basis.
And that is the only option as one of us who, not necessarily.
Oh, I see. Well, I mean.
Feeling super strong in the area.
You can draw people in. There's town council.
Well, no, we have other discussions to have on that matter.
Later on.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. I don't want
to,
I'm sorry. I should.
I can't respond to that.
Right?
Yeah. Let me just go here with them. Is that good?
That's it.
Okay.
That's
Steve.
Well, first of all, I just want to say that our wanting to remove you temporarily or otherwise has nothing to do with your capabilities. I mean, I'm only speaking for myself, but I think I'm speaking for the three of us who don't have to be recused. When I say that, I mean, I think you've done a fantastic job as chairman. You're extremely capable. You're a great leader. That's not the issue. The issue all has to do with 255 Miriam and what Sue has explained, you know, feeling abandoned, but also just the optics of the whole thing. And I'm sorry that you felt ambushed. That was not right. But at the same time, I think that what we're responding to is that, number one, Sue and Alicia were ambushed at town meeting. They were ambushed by the developer who called them liars and who threatened to sue them.
Yeah, I
want to
be careful about you saying too much about the 255 matter.
And I think that they just felt ambushed in general by what was said, by people not stating that they didn't have a financial interest when they got up to speak, when they did.
Yeah.
And so I think they felt ambushed. I think that, frankly, we have felt ambushed since that town meeting by Chris Houston trying to call us and meet with us individually. I understand from his point of view why he wants to do that, but he has to understand that this is just not something we signed up for. And to be, to be emailed and called and what have you.
I just done all
can
that.
Can I finish?
Sure.
All we're saying?
Well, no, I'm nervous because you're talking about a lot of Tossie stuff.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? That's not
Tossie. Oh, I see.
That's
okay.
Why I'm
got it, got it, got it.
But that's material to the discussion.
I don't think I'm really talking about the Tossie itself.
Okay.
But anyway,
okay?
Let me just say that if this thing had died after town meeting, we wouldn't be having this discussion right now. Mm-hmm. Period, end of story. It's because of everything that has happened since town meeting that we are having this discussion.
Okay, so can I ask?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I just don't understand the connection between that and then removing me. Why is the answer to those problems removing me?
Go ahead.
Wait, Steve. I'm calling to you.
I think it's just a lack of confidence in your ability to handle.
I can't be there. I can't be there. I'm not allowed to be there. I can't be your leader there.
I know that, but it's just, it just feels chaotic. And I don't know how else to describe it. We're not happy.
You being not happy and me being removed are two separate matters. I mean, me being removed, I don't see how it makes you any more happy.
Well, believe me, I'm not happy about your being removed because I didn't wish we didn't have to go through this.
Right, yeah. So do you feel, let me just get to the point then. Yeah. Do you feel that the vice chair is a solution, is an acceptable solution?
I think it may be.
Okay.
Yes.
Alicia.
As I stated last week, the casting process was divisive and necessitated refusal to two board members. I fully expected the divisive process would end with a vote at town meeting. And instead, the Miriam Street neighborhood, which Tony is a member, is still active and has extended the duration of its document request to include the weeks after town meeting. Tony stated last week that he often has discussions with the neighborhood group he leads. He must therefore know of its activities, possibly including his group's demand for planning board records. Now, this is important.
Alicia,
can I please finish, Tony?
I'm just nervous. Council, can I get your opinions on me listening to this matter? Do I need to leave the room?
She's
talking about my neighborhood group and what it's doing related to a matter that I've recused myself of. I've, three meetings in a row, I had to be super careful. So that's why town council's here.
I think it's a good idea to be careful. I don't think you're at a place yet
Thank you.
Our current chair is a member of the group, implying by the document request that his own board handled the process improperly. In other words, Tony may be part of an ongoing adversarial action against his own board. Further, in addition to the threat of legal action implicit in the group's document request, there is a current effort to revive the TOSTE. The planning board cannot and should not work effectively to negotiate with our own chair. We need new leadership. And please let me finish, Tony.
I'm worried about you making claims that you know nothing of, and it's disparaging on me. I'm going to let you continue. Your claims of the motives and the plans of a group that you know nothing of is really bothering.
We let you read your statement uninterrupted.
No, because these are statements that I believe are out of order. You're talking about things and disparaging me about things that you know nothing of. So I'm nervous about that.
In an email to the planning board last week, Select Board Chair Chris Houston suggested that the planning board's concerns about conflict of interest with 255 Miriam Street are analogous to the Select Board's 751 Boston Post Road experience. The two cases are not at all analogous. In contrast to the Post Road, Tony is both the planning board chair and a leader of a neighborhood group that sued the town, proposed a major zoning amendment to settle that lawsuit under duress from the developer, denigrated the planning board's concerns over the amendment's shortcomings.
Okay, I feel like, town council, I feel like I need to stop. This has nothing to do with the matter before us. We're considering whether to create a position of a vice chair to deal with my recusal matters. Is it fair for me to cut the discussion off?
The chairman, you have the discussion to...
Okay, I'm going to cut that discussion off. Any discussion of my activities on a matter on which I've recused myself, I'm going to cut off.
None of this is remotely like 751 Boston Post Road. What would the Select Board have done if its own chair...
How does this relate to the matter before us? Please connect the dots.
To connect the dots is that we cannot go forward with you as the chair, and I'm telling you why.
Just set, no, that 751 has no play in this matter. Sorry. It doesn't. It's unrelated.
Finally, the planning board notes that we have never seen the lawsuit which has generated so much antagonism. All I know of the lawsuit is what Tony said at the last meeting.
Again, we're into lawsuits.
You said this at the last meeting. If you were concerned about recusal, why did you say it then? It was you said it last meeting. You referred to it in specifics, and I will.
Why are we talking about lawsuits
when we
have a matter before us on a vice chair position for the planning board? Please connect that dot.
I've told you because you have lost my confidence in your ability to lead our group impartially, and I think that it's material, the things I'm saying are material, and I think that it, I'm greatly distressed that you would attempt to stifle my speaking.
Anything else?
Yes.
Not on the 255 matter, and not on the 751 matter. Is there anything else you'd like to share? Any debate you'd like to have?
Whether or not these activities amount to an actionable conflict of interest, some of us on the planning board believe they create incredibly bad optics.
The whole point of a recusal is to remove myself.
Please let me finish.
If there is a conflict of interest, I've done that. I've outlined all the lengths I've gone to make sure I'm operating properly. And like I said, in dealing with the state and dealing with town council, I also listed all my personal activities, and those were all approved. So we don't need to challenge that, I believe.
I'm saying, I'm not challenging, I'm repeating something you said last week. And you also compared this to Steve O stepping into the audience during occasional recusals. But you cannot compare them because, unlike the Merriam Street neighborhood group, Steve has never had financial ties to applicants. To us, this undeniable appearance of a conflict has threatened our ability to weigh the issues.
It's not an appearance of a conflict. It is a conflict. I've recused myself.
Tell me.
It is a conflict.
Tell me.
I'm open.
You're
open,
out of
open
order.
About it a year ago.
You interrupted me over and over. That is not how a meeting should be run. Are you going to allow me to finish, please?
It's challenging for me because you're off topic so often. Continue.
It has therefore impaired our ability to perform the jobs we were elected to do. The clearly adversarial nature of recent activities has exacerbated this. These dysfunctional circumstances have eroded our confidence in Tony's ability to lead the planning board effectively in executing our responsibilities. I hope that Tony will appreciate the somewhat truncated reasons, because I wasn't allowed to say them, for this motion and accept our vote that he stepped down from his position as chair.
Okay.
I move to take from the table the motion I made at our 1-8 meeting. And that was that we elect
the chair. We're in the middle of a motion to establish the position of the vice chair. Okay. Any thoughts from the audience?
Well, since I'm being portrayed as a stalker, I'd like to say I've never tried calling any of you about this, Steve. I emailed you. You said, I don't want to talk to you. I said, well, I'd like to tell you why it's urgent. Then the only other email after that was to tell you last week, hey, quit making allegations in a public meeting that I've been having backdoor conversations with Tony when it's patently false. So last week it's that. This week it's that I've been like calling you like some stalker. I mean, I don't know what your issue is, but just quit saying false stuff about me, please. Thanks.
I believe you've texted.
I'm not as well.
I know you texted Alicia.
I've texted Alicia through the time when we were having regular conversations, and one of those texts was, I can't wait to talk to you, Chris, when I get done with this.
All I can tell you is that we all feel harassed.
Okay.
That's our reality.
Trust me, we are totally happy. You're making the next discussion item much easier.
That's an interesting statement.
Well, it is. I'll tell you why when I get to that agenda item.
There's no characterization of you as a stalker.
Okay, Alicia, I haven't.
What's our
word? I just haven't recognized you. Okay.
I noticed that.
Okay, great. Any other comments? Great. Yes.
Well, I'm sorry that you felt abandoned. That's not a good feeling. But it seems that the solution you're suggesting, or the one suggested at the last meeting, doesn't solve that problem. With the motion on the table right now, you do a very good job solving that problem because you would have a known leader for a particular issue on which the chairman has recused himself. And I think it's really important to remember the importance of the power of recusal in town meetings. It's a very small group, and we depend on, in this town, we depend on volunteers to staff all of our committees. And so this, I think, would be a kind of dangerous precedent to set if we suggested that a chairman would have to resign if he had, or he or she had, a matter on which they felt she had, or he or she had recused himself. So I think the power, the purpose of recusal is just for situations like this, and the power of the ability to recuse properly makes government work better. I think that this solution that is on the table to vote in a vice chair is a very sound idea. And I think it should perhaps be thought of more as the form of good government in small committees, because these things are going to come up again and again in different committees, not just this one. So I think it would go a long way to solve the problem.
Can you identify yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Susan Scott.
Okay, and your address?
And 67 Silver Hill Road.
Thanks so much. Mario, identify
yourself. Mario Alani, 75 Bowles Street.
Great.
I was just about to say she didn't identify herself, and that was one of the things that you asked for at the beginning, neither did Chris Houston.
Okay,
and Chris Houston. I'm very, very uncomfortable with the way you keep cutting off Alicia. She can't say a word.
Okay.
I just think that that's, you didn't cut her off, you didn't cut anybody else off, and you just, I don't feel comfortable with the fact that she can't say what she wants to say.
So, Mario, I'll explain that. I felt like that. Remember, I'm recusing myself on 255 matters, and which she gets into the details of lawsuits or whatever she was saying with regard to 255 matters. It gets me very nervous about participating in that.
I didn't think she got in detail. I thought
Let me answer now. Okay. And the other is I just didn't see the connection to 751. I felt like that was going to be an unending discussion. There's much controversy swirled around all 40B, so. I felt like we needed to sum up the conversation, and I felt like it was off topic. So, sorry you feel that way.
Well, then, let me say another thing, if I may be there.
Sure.
It's not regarding 751, and it's not as specific about the matters at hand about which you've accused yourself, but it is a point of fact that your neighborhood group has sued the town. And you mentioned it at the meeting last week, Tony. You said that you sued the town because, I forgot the exact words that you used, the neighborhood group is suing the town appealing the ZBA's decision.
That is exactly the 255 matter.
But that's,
so that's exactly what I don't want to talk about.
But you yourself brought it up last
right,
week.
Right, okay. Right, I said it.
So I'm
right,
stating
okay,
it, okay?
Great.
So you are
that's
you're
on
part
record
of the neighborhood
already.
Group that has sued the town. You proposed a major zoning amendment to settle a lawsuit under duress from the developer. You denigrated our concerns. You filed a FOIA request for our town planning board records. The group has paid the research fees and extended the FOIA
okay,
request.
I'm going to stop that discussion. I've recused myself on those exact topics. I've recused myself. I don't want to be hearing them, and I don't want to be even thinking about attempting to respond to any of them in a public setting.
But those are the reasons that we cannot have.
Yes,
sir. Well, in the interest of moving, is somebody
sure.
else want to speak? Go ahead.
Jim Palando, 2542 Marion Street. I'm an adjacent abutter to 255. The only reason I want to speak is because Alicia just said that Tony proposed the bylaw. He never proposed the bylaw.
Said a neighborhood group that
stop. Can I finish, please? Now it's my turn? The neighborhood group got together and worked out a bylaw.
Jim, I want to be nervous. I want to be careful here, too.
I will.
These are things I don't want to be a part of hearing or attempting to respond to or moderating. Anything related to the 255 matter. Is that okay?
Yeah, it was not proposed by Tony.
I didn't say Tony. I said part of a neighborhood group.
No, you said it was proposed by Tony.
Interest of time, too.
In the interest of time and the fact that we are obviously going to stay at stalemate and that you have proposed a viable, what I consider a viable solution, and I appreciate the fact that after you've done telling us the background that you came up with a possible solution, and I like the idea of that.
Okay.
And
are we ready for a vote?
I don't know.
When do we have to choose the vice chair?
We have to.
Not, we would be later on.
I would be very interested and willing to schedule that for the next meeting. Because I think you don't have to. Can you be on the phone?
I can.
Okay. I think you need three because there's going to be two of us.
We wouldn't count towards quorum. Yeah, she's not.
A remote participant may not have to participate.
Even when it's reduced.
Because it's four of you voting.
I mean, you can't participate.
Alexa, she's nervous about me electing a vice chair, right?
You?
She's shaking her head.
Well, good.
Just go ahead.
My thought would be that it would be best if you recuse yourself from that, because the whole purpose of the, of choosing a vice chair is to be able to preside when you can't. And so rather than having it look like you were delegating or picking or approving of someone, having it be completely separate would be better.
If I want to pick the best person or the worst person, you know, depending.
Just to get.
And Leslie as well?
I'm not familiar with.
She's recused herself from 255.
Right.
But she's not the chairman.
I also have a question. When you, if we were normally doing your electing of a chair and a vice chair, we'd all be voting on it. Now, whether it means we have to do secret ballots so that we don't know who's.
No, she's not comfortable with that.
Secret ballots aren't, you can't do secret ballots.
But if we were, if this was just a regular day, and it's the day after the town meeting, and we wanted to elect our chair and our vice chair, doesn't everybody vote at that point?
Yes.
Okay, so?
It's that the reason that you are appointing a vice chair or selecting a vice chair is specifically to deal with the matter, matters in which, I mean, not every matter, but matters in which Tony has a conflict. So for Tony, I don't think it makes sense for him to participate.
Okay, so I am also a member of the same neighborhood group. I am not the chair. Is it, which way do you feel? Can I be part of this vote for a vice chair?
Clarification, are we talking right now about a vote to have a vice chair or a vote for the person?
No, we're not talking about the person.
The choice.
It's just the position of.
Far down the road.
Just the position.
To have a vice chair, fine.
I'll read it again before we vote.
All right, let's start with the basics.
Can I ask an audience question?
Sure.
Are you going to vote for, if this is approved, you're going to vote for a vice chair tonight?
No.
And if not, is that going to be another vote away?
Council was concerned about voting for a vice chair tonight because it's too far away from the agenda listed.
Okay. All right.
Can we put it on for the next one?
Surely put on for next time, but Sue's not going to be there.
Sue won't be here, and the other two of you won't be here, so we won't have quorum.
I'm allowed to vote, and if she counts as a quorum, then I can.
Is there any reason that she can vote and I can't?
Probably not. I can look into it. Probably there isn't a reason that, you know, that you two would be treated the same way for purposes of the conflict of interest law. And I guess I always suggest kind of taking a conservative approach if you have the option. And the conservative approach would be the most protective for of your interests.
Yeah.
We could have a special meeting. We have a special meeting just to elect the vice chair.
I'm just wondering if the first, the number one thing is you have to establish a quorum. I can't count as a quorum, so I'm doing a remote participation.
Yeah.
And we'll be back for the first meeting in February.
When are you leaving? Like tomorrow? Is my point. Like, can you meet in 3 days?
Well, let's have first have to meet the question about whether there is a vice chair on the table.
I understand. Okay, so we'll work at scheduling that, is the point.
Yes.
Okay, got it. Okay, so now I'm going to ask for a vote on the motion. Jerry?
Jerome Haber, 15 Bradle Road. I'm a member of the neighborhood group. Just for the record, I'm curious. What violation of his recusal did Tony commit, or what ethical violation did Tony commit as chairman?
I'm sorry, I think that's very specific
exactly
to what the board is talking about. That's a public discussion.
No, I'm asking a question. Was
I don't think any of us accused him of committing an ethical violation.
I didn't say you did. I'm just asking. I'm asking a question. I'm not saying you said that. I'm saying, was there any violation of his recusal, or did he violate any ethical standard that you're familiar with in relationship to removing Tony from the plan?
Okay, I'm going to continue on to the vote. Is that okay? Great. Okay, great. So the motion on the table is to create a motion to create a position of vice chair of the planning board, serving as chair on matters on which the chair has recused himself, or herself, I guess is probably better. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay, the motion is passed. Thanks, appreciate it. So I think we're done with that agenda item, and we're now on to.
No, because we could still have Tony, we still have my table motion from last time for a new chair, and a vice chair does not, a vice chair could be a vice for anyone who's the current chair, in case there's a necessary recusal. And I still would move that we move from the table, move to take my motion from the table, and that was to have new chairs, and if indeed we cannot have three, I think we could say we can have two, and I would nominate.
So, Alicia, I'm gonna make a statement here, so after conferring with town council, you elected me to a one-year term, there are no legal provisions for removing me during that term, so there's no opportunity this time for a reappointment, reorganization, and your motion is not proper.
Well, since we have town council here, I'd like to know, I was looking at the town guidebook tonight, and it did not specify a term, please tell me where that does appear.
Mr. Chairman, so the planning board statute provides that the planning board shall elect annually a chair. When a statute provides for a term found in law, so that's annually 1 year, then there's only a right to remove if the statute says there is, and there is not. It doesn't say that in the statute.
Okay, so in
your the guidebook is kind of a general statement for all boards. It doesn't mean that every single provision applies exactly the same for every board.
Okay, we're done with this topic, and
you guys are going to continue.
Thank you.
Sure.
Before we do that, I don't know where this fits into all of this, but it seemed to be the three that were left were unclear who was in leadership. And I heard people say that Steve was a temporary leader. So the question is Steve still?
Let them deal with this.
Okay, you
this
deal with it. All right. But last time you
stuff.
Were dealing with it.
But we're going to.
Whatever.
We'll connect with EMI on the best time to get the vice chair appointed.
So, yeah, the soonest, just FYI, the soonest we can possibly done is Friday.
Right. Got it.
We would like that never to happen then either.
Thank you.
It's later. So that's but while we're doing a while Leslie's doing a break here, I want to discuss with Alicia whether do you want to talk about this next one, Alicia?
Which are we doing next?
255 Merriam, do you wanna slow down? Oh yeah. Have a break, that's fine, and then we can
break and then we'll do it.
And we'll come back to this.
Please come over to the chair.
I think you should have the chair.
I think you should.
Well,
she's one of them.
She's one of
them. Yeah.
She's one of them.
She's one of them. Yeah.
Okay.
And she, but she's familiar with why this is on.
Yeah,
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you. And Katie came. So now you're
in
that.
Sorry,
you're
sorry, sneaky
good
in the back.
Landies, but,
All right.
Hi. Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
I'm the chair of the public hearing, which says, I may get to ask one question about an answer. So,
Yeah.
We come back to order, and I think the first item is to elect a chair for this meeting.
Should I make a proposal?
Yes.
I propose that we elect Alicia to the chair for this matter.
I don't know if I can say all of it. Okay, all of it.
We'll say all of it.
Aye.
Okay. So regarding 255 Miriam Street, this is a letter that we got today from town council, and we understand that, and we're familiar with the planning board, I mean, the select board, working with the group to bring forward a solution. The planning board is likewise interested in bringing forth a solution, because it is, after all, our purview to make zoning and land use decisions and recommendations to the town. And in the effort to bring forth a solution, we propose the appointment of a consultant who would work with an expert on land use to work with the town and work with the planning board and with the neighborhood group as a liaison to solve this issue for us.
Coordinate
between town boards, the neighborhood group.
All town boards.
All town boards.
Lack of communication.
All town boards, the neighborhood group, then, and the developer. And.
And how about us?
Well, we are a town board, all town boards.
But we're included in that.
Report to us, and for, advise us and to what action we would take towards bringing forth a new amendment to, a new proposal to, if it does come to town meeting. And so it's somewhere back there, but I would nominate that we ask Al Adelot to be a consultant. And.
Do we, is this a vote?
Do we have a,
this would ask.
So I would nominate that. So I can.
Could Al talk to us a little bit? I mean, is he willing to accept this?
Are you willing? Is it an assignment you've been willing to accept?
Her delaying task, cleaning up your gene stables?
Am I suicidal?
Yes.
Yeah.
Or at least a masochist.
I'll give it my best shot.
We would appreciate that, Al, as a leading expert in the town on all of these matters, and
it's been 6 months of rest from this.
Exactly, who has successfully solved similar issues in the past and has an institutional memory that cannot be matched anywhere. So for those reasons, we would like Al to spearhead this for us.
So do we need our vote?
Yes. Did we make a motion?
No.
Okay.
We make a motion. I move that we appoint Al Adelot to be a consultant as described by Alicia.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And did we have another meeting where Al will, or how did we, because we had so many emails last week with you trying to set up this process, how we would handle this.
So
where did we end up?
So we'll probably have to, let's discuss that a little bit, maybe with the group, so we can work out some timing now that, you know, folks are here. You know, I know that, Chris, you were looking to move quickly on this to, you know, keep the developer engaged, I guess, for lack of a better term. You know, knowing now that the planning board is interested in pursuing, you know, some kind of you know, mutually acceptable solution, is it too late, knowing that we'll lose quorum next week of this particular board here, we'll only have two people physically present, is it too late for those timelines to talk about this on the 5th?
That's what I was wondering when I asked about when you're going to be appointing a vice chair, because it's like kind of a vice chair. And I mean, I should be clear, when I talked about talking to Al, I've talked to other non-chairs too. Informal communication among boards is routine. We talked dozens of times in November, so I still am confused by the new 4 weeks ago saying, no, we don't want to talk to you about any of this outside of the meeting. But regardless, my question is, are you intending that whatever Al's gonna be doing is going to be parallel and basically separate, so like what I and the neighbors and the developer have already discussed, do you think that's going to be sort of superseded, or is the, like, hope that Al would actually talk to me in a way that you guys didn't want to, so that we could have conversations and try to come out to something really is just one mutually agreeable solution. I can't tell which direction you guys want to go on this.
We would like us to work together. We have never not wanted to work together. We have never not wanted to work with the selectmen. I think that the characterization that we didn't want to talk to you is not completely accurate.
I have the emails that say I don't want to talk to you.
We don't want
to
talk separately. We wanted to talk as a group. That's the difference.
Okay.
And we are...
So the issue is
like
that we're now 4 weeks later.
Yes.
And if you're saying that it just... So it's like, if the answer is you guys are essentially deputizing Alan, Alan and I can go have coffee tomorrow and start hashing some of this tomorrow in New York, maybe Friday, that we can start hashing this out and then coordinating with the neighborhood group and the developers, see if there's a good opportunity for the kumbaya that, frankly, I think all of us were like sunnily optimistic about at the end of December, then that works. If it's, well, no, he's gonna do stuff separately and then he's not gonna be able to present it to us for 4 weeks and then we're gonna have to talk about it and decide how it integrates, then, I mean, 4 weeks from now, if that's the approach you want to take, I would say 4 weeks from now, you'll have already gotten a proposed bylaw from us.
Well, you are,
because,
of course, welcome to propose any bylaw you
wish
at any time.
I know that even if Al and I have coffee, there's a chance that he'll say, no, we got to do it this way, and that's not the way that the developer or the select board or the neighbors want to do it. Well, so we'll make another proposal. I mean, there's no rule that says we can only have one.
Correct.
I would love for there to be only one.
We would prefer there be one, and we think that as the planning board is the land use department and the planning department for the town, we would prefer it come from us. And we have a lot of expertise here in the room,
yep,
who will help us, and we are also have creative minds who can help work on
it. Nothing would have pleased me more than to reach out to the neighbors and have them say, hey, someone from the planning board already called, they want to pursue a solution already, we're good, okay? I know that you might, from what you say, I'm perceiving that you're bristling at the fact that why has the select board even inserted themselves in this? It's because, you know what, if we didn't, no one would have. And time was running. If we just said, well, let's wait for something to happen, right now the developer would have already pulled his permits and start work. And the farther he goes down that road, the less likely he is to say, okay, fine, I'll stop and do something else. So that's why time was of the essence 4 weeks ago. You know, so I'd love it. I think there's still a good possibility for a solution, but it, I mean.
Well, I'm speaking for myself, but I would envision that Al would be deputized to report back to us with his findings. I think he has some creative ideas already that I personally have reviewed and found very, and Imai looked at them over and we thought that they were extremely promising and we could move quickly, but.
All right, well, this
whole
is
board
one
hasn't
thing,
seen
right, and one of the things, watching the video of the select board meeting the other night, which was very good, nice presentation, but you did say that you had asked Imai if this was perhaps not the wisest, the best planning practice to zone a single parcel. And then you said, and this is a direct quote, best practice would say you don't do that kind of thing. So this was your admission that this is exactly the kind of thing
you
don't do.
Oh, no, I was conceding his hypothetical.
Correct.
I don't know what
okay. Yeah. And then you went on to explain, you know, that best practices are awesome, but sometimes the real world gives you reason to deviate from best practices. You said that in your tax law practice, you've sometimes had to deviate from the actual best practice in order to move something forward. And I get that, because I think lawyers can do that because they generally don't sue each other. And also, if you make a big mistake, just generally in tax law, you end up with a big fine or a prison term. However, right now with this kind of thing, this has got to do with zoning, and these are irrevocable issues. So that, you know, I just can't move on this unless I hear assurance that the proposed bylaw, and this would have to be the final proposed bylaw that we hammer out, all of us hammer out, won't spawn a large number of copycat proposals, because this is really important. This is decades worth of hard work by Susan Haber and the town planners,
They created the way this town looks. We can undo it in a heartbeat. And I'm very worried about that. So I don't want it to be that you guys, because it's, we don't have to always follow best practice. I would really like you to follow best practice. I'm a nurse, you know. If I didn't follow best practice, I would get sued. There was no leeway. And I, yes.
If you came across a car accident and had to get someone to check you out, I mean, best practice would say you should sterilize and you should do all this stuff.
I did not say life-threatening things. I worked in the OR. We did a lot of stuff. But you don't. We have time. This really isn't an emergency. Don't tell me it's an emergency.
Okay.
We're trying to move quickly.
The emergency is that the developer tomorrow could walk in and pull the permit. This is all dead. So this is not
right.
a...
Okay, except he is
Chris,
willing to
if
talk.
I could just weigh in here,
yes.
Calm down.
Well,
I think we'll work something out, honestly.
I'm looking forward to going to coffee with you.
Yeah, let's see if we can work something out.
I'm trying to set the expectations.
I think we're that close.
Okay.
We're very close.
All
right.
We
wouldn't have brought this forward if we didn't think we could work on something.
Okay, you're saying what I hoped you would say, that you want us to
talk. We're willing to move forward. However, I don't want best practices just to be completely shunted to the side.
Wasn't suggesting shunting them completely to the side.
Okay, good.
Al.
I have some thoughts on how you could actually still comply with best practices.
Exactly, that's our goal, to have best practices and solve the neighborhood dilemma and not open up the town to...
Chris, I appreciate what you're trying to do, believe me. I have a little bit more experience than you do in juggling zoning bylaws. I have some thoughts on how we might be able to address they're talking about the spot zoning provision, and I have some thoughts on how we could address that.
I believe you, I'm genuinely eager to have that conversation. I wish we could have had it 4 weeks ago, but...
I wasn't on the board.
No. I wish someone had told me to just call you 4 weeks ago.
Al, could you talk about the process a little, and how you see it in your mind to address some of Chris' concerns, and I think
I'd like to
find out what the goals are, and if for the developer, for the neighborhood, how those goals could match with what's suitable for the town as a whole, how they can be satisfied by the town as a whole, for working for the town as a whole, how to construct a bylaw that actually works for the town and for the neighborhood. So I'd like to talk, I've been out of the loop on this for, 9 months. I'd like to talk to the neighbors, I'd like to talk to Chris, and I'd like to get some feedback, and maybe by next Wednesday, next week, come up with some possible ideas of how we could address some of these issues. That's what I'd like
That's
to do.
That's great. So we could put that on the agenda for next week?
So maybe we could meet, Sue could call in, and we wouldn't be voting, we would just be hearing a presentation. Does that count? Can you do that?
So, that gets, I think, into a little iffy area of the open meeting law, because you're not at a meeting because there's not a quorum, but you still are at a meeting. So
even if you post,
what
it
is that? I mean, if we were going to do that, I would absolutely post it. I would absolutely say the public could stay.
Exactly.
I would absolutely keep it as open as possible. It's a little weird.
I'm worried about Lauren saying no, unless you want to say no right now. But I mean, I think the telephoning in rules are pretty clear, so let me throw out at least one other possibility without knowing if it works for any of you. We have a selectman meeting Tuesday night, similar to our meeting, was it a week ago? And you track the time when I said, look, we can't wait till February 5th, so
right.
I'm just going to present it. You can either come or watch the video or whatever. Al, you free to come Tuesday night?
And that leaves
Al talks to the select board about his ideas, which is, I mean, we're a relevant audience for it.
And
you
then
guys can show
but
up.
Then she's away, so it'll be the two of us.
And
so
you can
we
dial
would,
in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can dial in or watch the video or both. It's fun. I think you guys can't deliberate among yourselves.
Right. Right.
They can ask questions, right?
I can't make it up Tuesday.
Oh, you can't. Well, I can. All right. Okay. All right. So.
Even if you watch the video, is that better than...
I'll watch the video.
Do you want to call in? I will handle your call in, and then Steve can't come, you can watch the video. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Not live, but the next day or whenever they post it. So I would come to the select board meeting, you would call in, Al would present. Al, is that okay? You would have time to get something.
It's not a lot of time.
I know.
But I'll do my.
But it'd be a start.
We can list it, it's better than waiting another 2 weeks.
Right, it'd be a start.
What are we doing on Wednesday night?
We wouldn't be doing anything to this relative Wednesday night.
There's no agenda for the Wednesday night meeting?
No, relative to this.
Yeah, I was gonna say, we can, but on Wednesday night, you can go ahead, and you'll have a full board anyway, because neither Tony nor Leslie have to accuse themselves, because you're not talking about anything on 255, right?
Yeah, we'll still have a meeting, we'll still have a meeting.
We'll still have a meeting.
Yeah, just not a meeting on this.
Right, there just will not be anything to say about this.
I mean, alternatively, if I can, I mean, Al, if you think the extra day would be helpful, I'd be open to, what time is your meeting?
Seven.
Seven.
If I can get one of the selectmen to show up, we could declare a 6 o'clock meeting that you would present to, I would talk to, and you, all three of you could be in the audience again, as long as you're not. Well, you can dial in.
Yeah, she can dial in.
As long as you're not deliberating.
Right. We will be, we are allowed to ask questions.
We're members of the audience.
Right, that's right.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah.
Does six work for you, Steve?
It's tough, isn't it?
It's tough, but I can try.
Or, I mean.
I'll figure it out.
I could say it late. I mean, if you want to do it late after your main business, but unless it's one of those things that goes to like 11 o'clock.
Is this on the 21st?
Twenty-second is gonna be, fairly long.
So maybe we should try.
I would, if you were gonna do it, I'd do it before.
I can't.
Get there at six?
No, I'm gonna be lucky if I get here at seven.
Okay, fine.
What about,
At the end of the meeting?
Thursday?
Well, then we're going on, more than a week. Right, so then.
I know, but if Tuesday's gonna be just too soon to really.
I'll give it my best shot. I mean, I've gotta gather a lot of information and sift through stuff, so.
Well, do you want to put us on your agenda for Tuesday anyway, and then we'll try for that, Al?
If we need another meeting Thursday or Friday, I say, I just have to fetch, because you're out of town the whole week, too.
Yeah.
I can hopefully fetch one selectman to.
Right.
That meeting.
So Al, when do you get input from the board?
Let me, oh, you're here. I can ask you this. Can I ask a town council question? My understanding is that Al could, or even Imai, could talk to all three of them separately, and so long as he didn't say, talk to Alicia and then say, okay, I got it, and then talk to Steve and say, oh, that's what he said, oh, well, here's what Alicia said, then it's fine. If he's just taking their input.
He cannot relay it.
Well, he could tell us what he's found, and then we could give questions to Imai, right? Can't we do that?
If it's a one-way communication.
One-way?
And he's not sharing with, he's not being basically a conduit for deliberation.
The only thing you have to avoid is sort of serial communication that masquerades as a deliberation.
But if you three give your input to Al on Tuesday, Wednesday, whatever, and then Al communicates with me, that's not a problem, because I'm not on your board.
Right.
Or to the neighbors, or to the developer.
Where did we end up, Imai? Where are we meeting?
So it sounds like you're meeting Tuesday, and there is a lot to do, and consider that.
The select board.
And consider that the 20th is a holiday.
Right.
Oh, yes.
Right.
So that's, you know, that's gonna be just tight on timing. Tight on getting everything done, and I don't think you'll really get a feedback loop in that time. I think, you know, I don't know that it's possible to go out, talk to neighbors, gather input, give that to you, and get feedback in that quick of a turnaround.
I'd like to hear what Al thinks his biggest obstacles will be on this. How you figuring, how you gonna wrangle this, Al?
Can you still get a board to join us? Or come up
at
least
here? What if I just stand up?
Oh, that'd be good, thank you.
It's a matter of timing. I want to try to arrange a couple of meetings with people, talk to people, get feedback, find out what their goals are and aspirations, see if I can fit that into some kind of a concept that, would fly as a zoning bylaw, framework. I frankly think Chris's efforts have been positive. I would agree with what he's been trying to do. So I think it's a matter of plugging that into that framework and getting something that works. But it's just a matter of, you know, scheduling the meetings, who am I talking to, you know, and getting all that done in the next 5 days, and then coming together with a proposed framework and throwing that on the wall and saying, here's some thoughts. So I'll try my best, and so let's see what happens.
If Tuesday's, I mean, that when you put it like, sorry about this residual thought. When you put it like that, it's, Tuesday seems aggressive. Because, I mean, I think, I'm hoping that we'll have an initial conversation toward the beginning of when you have these other conversations, and then we'll have a follow-up conversation to see how close to the same page we are.
Well, I will say, I watched the selectmen's meeting.
Yeah.
And so I got a sense of where you are,
okay.
And I understand what you were working on, and I have to say I agree with including the affordable house in the mix. I think that's a great idea, and I think the real snag here is where to stick this in the zoning bylaw and how to resolve the spot zoning issue.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can do that, if we can figure out a good place to put this in the zoning bylaw and work out the spot zoning issue, I think we'll be pretty close to there. But I just want to find out if there are other issues, other goals that people have that I don't know about that need to be incorporated into whatever the framework is. That's all.
Right. I think, I can speak to some of that. Obviously, the neighbors can. The developers are key. Constituent
yeah,
that needs to be talked to on that.
I'd like to find out if his goals are synonymous with the neighborhoods.
I don't know if now or some other time this, I mean, we tried to talk about the spot zoning thing at our select board meeting. So, I mean, I think from our standpoint, what I heard you saying is a practical matter, it's really not, like, shouldn't necessarily be a showstopper. But
I think I have a way to,
okay, good.
To take that off.
So, but going back to the timing, I'm just wondering if we should think about maybe trying to do this Thursday or Friday next week as a follow-up presentation, and we'll just create some meeting. Tuesday seems like it might be.
That's pretty tight.
That's pretty tight, yeah.
Yeah.
But I think we should be able to cobble together a selectman meeting on Thursday or Friday, say.
Okay. That's fine. That's every day.
And I think that it's still a moving things quickly enough that the developer's not going to be like, you guys are sandbagging, so we're out here. I think he's genuinely trying to work.
I think as long as we're making an effort to get there, that's
right.
Seems to me that
yeah,
would be
no, I'm
encouraging.
Very encouraged by all this.
And the planning board wants to be a part of the discussion.
Okay.
That's
so why
I think I saw some people
ago.
Asking questions in the audience, so if we have a minute.
So, well, just to wrap it up so we know what we're doing, you're going to look to schedule a meeting Thursday or Friday, right, Chris?
Right.
Board was okay.
So Tuesday's not happening.
Tuesday just seems aggressive. Plus our meeting, we got the budget presentation.
Okay, so that's not happening, and then we'll appear, it'll be later in the week.
Steve, is your schedule
Tuesday?
No,
it's Monday.
6 or 6:30?
Yeah.
It depends on the day.
No, next Wednesday. Is that just like?
Oh, next Wednesday.
Could you do it late?
No, I can't because I don't even know. I don't think I'm going to get here by 7.
Yeah. Oh,
I have
okay.
4 to 5
right.
Meeting.
No,
okay.
No, no, no. Yeah. Oh, God.
We'll
no,
settle.
No, forget it.
You guys let you might know your availabilities
yes,
on
yes.
Thursday and Friday next week.
Yep.
They're saying Friday next week.
Okay. Yes.
I have a question.
Please identify yourself.
Barbara Casey, 40 Hamilton Road, Weston.
Yes.
I picked up on something that Susan said. Now, this zoning bylaw that we're discussing, is that just specific to 255 Howard Hill Road? Or as Susan intimated when she spoke, will this kind of make it happen all over town? And we're going to see it happening all over town?
That was
which will really change the nature of the town that we moved into.
That is the crux of the entire issue.
I mean,
yeah.
it's... driving on the streets now is impossible.
So.
And you're looking to put more and more houses on a smaller and smaller property.
I can say that from my discussions with town council, even the prior version would not have used the phrase that came up in my conversations with Al, metastasized across town because of the way it was drafted.
How do you know that? Somebody's gonna say, oh, but they did it there and that's legally, we can do it again.
Well, that's, well, that's
that.
Different.
Can you guarantee that's not gonna happen?
I can guarantee you that that bylaw, as it was drafted, could not be extended so that people are putting these things all over town. I could not guarantee that someone wouldn't come along and say, that seems like a good idea down in this neighborhood, but that would require the passage of a new bylaw, or revision of this one.
But precedent
will
have
been set.
That's our concern.
That's the concern.
Precedent will have been set.
And that's why we're trying to come up with one that would prevent that from happening. Is it Terry that right now?
I just want to make a comment about the timing, and I think I can really appreciate the importance of this to the neighborhood, but I also really appreciate the importance of it to the town. And I think the precedent setting is really an important matter, and I just want to encourage taking the time that's necessary to really look into this and make sure that this works for the town as well as for the neighborhood.
Thank you.
Jim Palando, 242 Merritt Street. Why do you think this is more precedent setting than the precedent that was set by the planning board with the AARD?
Well, we're, don't,
I asked a question.
I know, I'm saying that we're not prepared to debate all of the merits of the previous plan or this plan, but the AARD dealt with very large parcels of land, and I recall at the time there were only a couple of those in town, but it was not just one. But it was several large parcels of land.
Four parcels of land.
So there was a possibility that could have been replicated in four places. It wasn't spot zoning, but it was the size requirement that would have prevented it from popping up in any little neighborhood.
Your point is well taken, because that one little thing, you know, it really shouldn't. Your point is well taken about, you say people have taken this as, that's a precedent to do this all over town. And so anytime we change something that seems to be spot zoning, even though that really wasn't, it will come back to haunt us.
But I guess my point is that one of the arguments you used during town meeting was that there's no lot of 2.9 acres or anything else that's anywhere close to this near the three train stations, which is the limitation of that bylaw that you proposed. You haven't been near a train station. But you agreed that, you could buy other lots and conglomerate up to 2.9. So you can conglomerate other lots up to 50 acres.
So you're still discussing
acres.
The TOSD,
yeah.
Which is over with?
No, it's not.
It isn't. You're telling me it is.
No.
You're saying TOSD is long gone.
It's
no longer transportation oriented, correct?
Yeah.
Is that how this is being?
I don't think we said we were necessarily getting rid of the transportation part, right?
Well, no, it would be pretty hard because it doesn't run right by the door.
Nobody ever did.
But
so,
is this going to come to town meeting as a transportation-oriented senior development with one affordable? Is that going to be the name of this?
I hope not.
I would like to come up with a more elegant
name. I think so, right.
But, I mean, if you wanted to achieve the purpose of limiting the scope of where this could possibly occur,
mm-hmm.
then you would adopt, or could, I'm not saying it's the only way to skin the cat. Sorry, that's a metaphor. But that would be one way to limit the scope, and then you add the affordable aspect, which has two things. One, it gets the town what was an important reason for not wanting to engage with the TOSD at all, namely the flatly stated upfront elimination of any affordable units. It also, confirmed with town council, makes this a substantively different proposal, so it's not subject to the two-year freeze.
But it's the main thing is to accomplish the goals of the neighborhood.
But protect the zoning throughout the town.
And to address what the possibilities are for other developments like it around town. I would just ask, Jim, I'd ask you to keep an open mind about what form that might take. Just as long as your goals are satisfied, then maybe there are other ways to deal with issues. The transportation orientation was one way to address, in a sense, the spot zoning issue. But it may not be necessary to tie this to the transportation. I'm not saying that's impossible, but I'm just saying there may be other ways to look at this that get exactly what you want, and a bylaw that actually addresses the planning board's concerns. I think there's a way to do that. And so what you guys want is an 8-unit development in Silver Hill that includes one affordable unit at this point. What I want to know, is there anything that you're interested in? Or do you have any other goals besides that? And we're not going to get to that discussion tonight, but I want to find out if there are goals I'm not aware of that need to be addressed. That's all.
And in response to you, Al, I didn't bring it up for that point. I brought up to the point that you're arguing something that's not anywhere near true. You're arguing it's spot zoning, but the ARD was also spot zoning. You can conglomerate and add on other lots to get a large enough parcel to be in ARD. So I just think you keep hanging this thing that it's going to ruin the town. It's a tool that's been used by the planning board in the past, and I think it's unfortunate that we're even sitting here talking about it as well. It was asked a long time ago for you folks to be involved, and you decided you didn't want to. That's the only reason we brought it up.
But we decided not to be involved.
I think the desire not to engage was because there was no affordable units, and for a variety of reasons that was objectionable to the town. The town, and I think I can say the town broadly, including planning board, select board at the time, didn't feel that we should be like engaging in something that's getting rid of affordable housing at a time when we were talking to all sorts of other neighborhoods about the need for affordable housing.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And not doing zoning around them,
right,
so that they wouldn't have to.
Right.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but right. So that there's a reason that the town didn't engage before, and I've have come to appreciate that and at least understand it, but. Now that there's the affordable thing, that's what I say. The collective desire from our first meeting, my first meeting with the neighbors and developers, was that everyone, including the planning board, would be involved with this to try to like find a way to make this work in a way that worked for the developer, worked for the neighbors, worked for the town as a whole.
Works for the town as a whole is our goal.
Al, you may win the Al Adelot Award.
Again.
For doing this.
Either that or be stood up against the wall somewhere.
That's possible too.
Jerome Haver, 15 Grail Road, I'm part of the neighborhood group. In terms of precedent, from another point of view, the TASDE required, or this sort of amendment requires, a two-thirds vote at town meeting. Right? So I don't quite get the precedent thing, because any other group in town, citizens group, can come forward, they can construct an amendment to the zoning bylaw and present it to the town and require a two-thirds vote. They don't need a TASDE amendment as a precedent in order to do that. So that's why when you keep talking about precedent, from a certain point of view, I don't see it for this reason.
I don't think you need to argue with this. We're trying to help you. We're trying to move forward and get this going.
But
so to rehash past objections, I don't think it's productive.
Earlier,
okay.
About precedent, and I'm just throwing a different spin on precedent in terms of that anyone can amend the bylaw.
And anybody
who sat on
the planning board will know how often we get approached with, but you did this,
right.
But you did this.
But I also think
and you're being inconsistent, and that's what we hear.
We're not just talking about the precedent of proposing a new bylaw. That's not the issue. It's a precedent of proposing a bad new bylaw, which we feel that the TASDE one was, for all the reasons mentioned before, and not just about zoning, many
right.
others.
Many issues, right.
So it's not, anyone can propose it, and that's okay. It's what that particular bylaw is all about. So
we are trying to move forward, and I think that will be mutually beneficial if you, are trying to move forward. Right?
Yes.
So are we done? We've got a meeting set. Al is our consultant.
Well, you guys, we don't have to do that.
Right, but we're
you guys
going
need to give
to,
your,
I'm saying we're going to,
yes.
Eli's going to set up a meeting, we have our consultant, and we're going to move.
Can you just cover the waterfront, include any availability during the daytime, because getting one of the other selectmen might require that.
Yeah, well, we'll
okay.
Talk to them. Okay. So we will.
We'll have to do a little joint sign-up thing.
The little dual button.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
That's actually going to help with
okay.
Stuff.
Right. Yeah. We can do a bulletin.
Okay.
Dual bulletin. Okay. He can do it. Somebody does it.
You know, alternatively, Al and I could just go have coffee at the old cottage on the
I thought you
time.
Had a
you guys,
date on Friday.
And you guys could, like, just happen to be in the booth, not just delivering anything, but just eavesdropping.
Next door.
Oh,
I have my own personal booth that he always used to
go. All right. Sorry, I was kidding.
Face the camera and say that was a joke.
Okay. So we have, so we will consider the discussion of 255 closed for tonight. Or
yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Now we will go to the public records request.
So that request, as I understand it, has been fulfilled.
I haven't turned anything in because I was out waiting to hear from you. I was waiting to discuss it.
They have town clerk. Has turned over, has a thumb drive with it. But what did you want to discuss about it?
Because I've never done one before, I would like to know what we do, how do we do it. I've never done one before.
Okay.
So I just want to know. So my things have not been turned in.
Okay.
And
well,
I would like to know what you do.
So basically, you go through your emails and your texts with the search terms that we sent out to you. I think it was Silver Hill, Hallett, or Merriam,
right.
Harris,
right.
And those.
I know, right.
Go through those. Any ones that are not to the town, because the town search will cover that.
Okay, so
the town search will cover anything you sent to me, but it's anything like personal email.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then I just
you
send to each other.
Yeah, you wouldn't have sent to each other, but like let's say a member, your neighbor emails you because they want to know something about that, and you respond to your neighbor. That's the kind of.
They
that.
Want that. They
yes.
Is it personal thing they do?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
No personal ones here.
I didn't
yeah.
know. Okay, I didn't
yeah.
know.
Yeah,
I,
yeah. So
okay.
You get all of those. That
okay.
captures those as well. Because that's discussing
what about marital privilege?
Public business.
There are some things that are off the table.
Yes, exactly.
Having
exactly.
had to do that,
okay.
I can tell you it's a big task.
Okay, well, good thing that he doesn't know how to text and never carries a phone, so I'm all set. Okay, so and then we send them to whom? To you?
To me.
Okay.
So you capture all of those, you send them to me. If you're checking your phones, take a screenshot, send it to me.
All right, because I have not done that because I was waiting to talk about it. And that is, they want everything through Christmas.
I don't remember exactly what this terms
through the
of date.
I have no idea what was requested.
Yeah,
Sherry. A new request was made, but I don't know if it's a
okay.
Who would have that document?
Well, we have it somewhere.
I have it on my email from the town
okay.
clerk. I mean, I know what it is. I know where to find it. I just don't have the.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's in my head.
So I guess we are done. Do we have a
move that we close the adjourn meeting at 8:31?
Oh, cool.
Second.
Aye.
I guess we would be done with 8:30.
That was correct.
Yep.
They like that one, Jim. I haven't been correct on times in a while. I think the time's good. Yeah. Yeah, we can talk about March
meetings. Yeah, we're having a meeting on the 11th.
On the 25th, yeah. That's what we have decided because...
Those are the ones I was invited to and then uninvited to.
Yeah.